And I'll tell you up front, I'm not going to compete with Obama in singing because I'm not running for entertainer-in-chief. I'm running for president. Thank you all very, very much, and thank all of you up here. I particularly want to start by thanking Attorney General Bill McCollum, who just has been a great statewide leader and has done so much to help us, and he and Ingrid have just been tremendous. I also want to thank Mayor Crotty and Alan Levine, who co-chaired statewide and really helped us put this together with a remarkably short time, and so we're very grateful to all of you. I also want to introduce my daughter Kathy and her husband Paul. They live down in Key Biscayne. And I'm very proud of Kathy because she did a whole series of Spanish language media over the last couple of weeks helping us in the Miami area and really reaching out across all of the Hispanic community. And also my daughter Jackie and her husband Jimmy, who are here. Jackie's been doing speeches, doing television and radio. And as many of you know, she is the she and Jimmy are the mother and father of my two major debate coaches, Maggie and Robert. So it's great to have them here. I want to thank Floridians. Chris and I talked about this, and everybody here has been so positive in every part of the state that we just thank all of you for the hospitality and the kindness. We thank the well over a half million Floridians who voted for us. And I think Florida did something very important, coming on top of South Carolina. It is now clear that this will be a two-person race between the conservative leader, Newt Gingrich, and the Massachusetts moderate. And the voters of Florida really made that clear. Now, you'll notice that a number of folks are holding up a sign about 46 states to go. We did this in part for the elite media because, you know, the same people who said I was dead in June and July and said I was gone after Iowa, who seemed totally quiet the night of the South Carolina victory, are now going to be back saying, what's he going to do, what's he going to do, what's he going to do? So I just want to reassure them tonight. We are going to contest every place, and we are going to win, and we will be in Tampa as the nominee in August. Now, you might ask, in the face of a 5-1 onslaught, how can that be true? And I'll give you the answer. It was stated at a historic moment in 1863 in dedicating our first national military cemetery by the President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, who said, we have government of the people, by the people, for the people, and we're going to have people power defeat money power in the next 6 months. And you might say, how are we going to do that? Well, the same way that we came back in June and July, and by December, we're ahead in the Gallup poll nationally by 12 or 13 points with no money. It turned out that if you have ideas and you have solutions and you're positive and you can communicate a better future and you have a history of actually doing something in the past, that the combination begins to reach the American people. So let me talk briefly about what this is going to be about, because this is the most important election of your lifetime. If Barack Obama gets reelected, it will be a disaster for the United States of America. Make no bones about it. If he can have a record this bad, unemployment this bad, deficits this bad, policies this bad, gasoline prices this high, and still get reelected, you can't imagine how radical he'll be in his second term. So designing and putting together a people's campaign, not a Republican campaign, not an establishment campaign, not a Wall Street-funded campaign, a people's campaign, and saying to every American of every background and every ethnic group and every community, we have a better future for you and your family. It's a future of jobs. It's a future of lower gasoline prices. It's a future of a balanced budget. It's a future of a smaller Washington. It's a future of more power back home to you and your family and your neighborhood. This is a future we ask you to join us in imposing on the establishment in Washington and imposing it on both parties. So let's talk briefly about the power of ideas. In 1980, I was very honored to be able to help put together the first Capital Steps event. And at that point, Senate and House candidates came together with Governor Reagan. David Broder wrote about it in the Washington Post as a very courageous decision by Reagan, because he didn't have to run as part of a team. And he did something nobody had done before. And we won 6 U.S. Senate seats by a combined margin of 75,000 votes, and we picked up 33 House seats. In 1994, building on that experience, we got 350 candidates to come and to be part of a contract with America to stand on the Capitol steps. We offered a positive program, and we had the largest one-party increase in American history in an off year. 9 million additional Americans voted for a positive vision, and we kept our word, and every item in the contract was voted on in the first 93 days. There's a core question, both in the primaries and in the general election. It's a simple question. If you're comfortable with the way America's decaying, then we don't have to change much. We can just manage the decay. But if you think that's a terrible thing to do to your children and grandchildren, it's a terrible thing to do to your country. And if you are prepared to do what it takes to make sure that we change direction, not just the presidency, but the Congress, the bureaucracy, the judges, the policies, so that the entire system gets on the right track, so that America can give our children and grandchildren a more prosperous, a safer, and a better future. This is how big the gap is. There are folks over here in both parties who are quite comfortable managing the decay. I am running, close to that I made the decision of running. Our children, our son-in-law has joined us in that decision, because we believe it is cheating our grandchildren to not insist on fundamental basic change in Washington, even if the establishment doesn't like it. In the next few days, we're going to develop the equivalent of the contract from 1994, except this is going to be a personal one between me and you, because I'm asking you to make me president. Therefore, I have a personal responsibility. It's going to come in two parts. Part one is conditional and requires your help. Part two I can do if I win the election without having to condition it. Part one only works if you help me and we run a team campaign. Which means, by the way, we have to replace Bill Nelson with a conservative. But if you help us, and in addition to winning the presidency, we elect a Republican Senate and a Republican House, I will ask them on January 3rd to stay in office, and I will ask them to immediately pass the repeal of Obamacare. I will ask them to immediately pass the repeal of the Dodd-Frank bill, which is killing housing, killing small business, and killing independent banks. And I will ask them to pass the repeal of Sarbanes-Oxley, which is crippling American businesses with no net profit. And my goal is to have all three bills sitting there waiting so the minute I am sworn in, I can sign all three, and we're off to a pretty good opening morning. Now, those three promises are conditional. We have to win the Senate by a big enough margin to manage it, and we have to increase our strength in the House. Help me do that, I'll do those three. Now let me tell you some things, and we're going to put this together in a way that you'll be able to see in writing with my signature, and you'll be able to hold me accountable. There are a series of executive orders I can issue that the Congress can't stop as long as they're within the law. The very first executive order will abolish all of the White House czars as of that moment. We will issue immediately an executive order on the same day. All this is going to happen about 2 hours after the inaugural address. Okay? No point in hanging out and having fun. Before we get to go to the various balls that night, we are going to have a work period, because this is going to be a working presidency. I may not get in as much golf as Obama, but I'll get in a lot more job creation. And I'll tell you up front, I'm not going to compete with Obama in singing, because I'm not running for entertainer-in-chief. I'm running for president. And I would say to him now, Mr. President, you cannot sing your way past the disaster of your presidency. Now, we will immediately, you know, I forgot my teleprompter. I said to my staff earlier, I mean, I'm having to wing this because of a staff failure. So, we're going to sign on that day the authorization for the immediate deployment of the Keystone Pipeline as of that day. My message to the people of Canada is, don't cut a deal with the Chinese. Help is on the way. By January, you're going to build the right pipeline to the right place. I'll just give you a couple more. We're going to put together a package. You're going to see this is what a serious conservative president is like, who is bold and is prepared to change Washington despite the screams of the establishment in both parties. So a couple more steps. We will, on that day, sign an executive order that will instruct the State Department that day to open the embassy in Jerusalem and recognize Israel. I'll give you just two more examples. I will sign that day an executive order reinstating Ronald Reagan's Mexico City policy. No U.S. money will go anywhere in the world to pay for abortion, period. And finally, many of you may have noticed that the Obama administration has declared war on the Catholic Church and other religious institutions. I want you to know that on the very first day, I will sign an executive order repealing every anti-religious act of the Obama administration as of that moment. The reason I'm comfortable telling you all this is I have been studying what America needs to do since the fall of 1958, when my dad was stationed in Europe in the Army. I have been working at what we need to do as Congressman, Speaker of the House, in the private sector. I believe it is possible to get this country back on track. My commitment is to unleash the spirit of the American people, to find new and innovative and positive things, to do them 7 days a week, to do them relentlessly, to do them without stop, to make sure that we have fundamentally gotten America back on the right track. And I pledge to each and every one of you personally, if you will reach out across the country, if you'll use Facebook and YouTube and Twitter and phone calls and even visits, if you will tell all of your friends in the other 46 states that there is a chance to nominate a conservative who knows what he's doing, who has done it before, and who has the courage and the determination to get it done. I promise you that if I become your president, I pledge to you my life, my fortune, and my sacred honor. This is about America. Thank you. Good luck and God bless you.
Wasn't drinking again, but Daddy left the proof on her cheek. And I always seem to be in the way. So I took myself down to the fair in town on Independence Day.
There's not much time left today, yeah.